Good evening. I'd like to call the January 14th school committee meeting to order. We are being televised live on RCTV. I'd also like to thank all the people that came out tonight. I know, but a combination of budget parents and people that are here to hear from the two cost centers that we're going to hear tonight, special education and then other services. So I'd like to keep report, actually, if there's any public input first that's not relative to the budget, if anyone wants to come up. Did you have? You can, thank you. You can just state your name. Sure, relax.
My name is Danya Mahoney, and I am a Latin teacher here at RMHS. And I know some of you have students and children, but I would like to speak tonight for a few moments about the importance of maintaining a strong Latin program and share with you some of the details of our Latin program, if I may. First, let me say that I'm not here to ask for my job or ask you to save my job. I have additional licenses, and I know that there is a role for me at RMHS where I can serve students and be supportive and love what I do every day as I do already. It does not matter to me whether I'm teaching Latin or teaching English or supporting students in the best way possible at RMHS. Thank you. Having said that, I have taught Latin for 22 years, and Latin is an important, although admittedly small, program here at RMHS. Mrs. Nancy Irons and I are both experienced, highly qualified Latin teachers with over 30 years' experience between us. We collaborate regularly, and both of us can teach any level of Latin. We currently offer 10 Latin classes with 5 unique levels, serving 130 students. We currently offer SCP Latin 1, SCP Latin 2, Honors 3, and Honors Latin 4, a combined program that allows students to continue for a full 4-year language program, reading, literature, and history. Our Latin program allows the students the opportunity to complete a rigorous, systematic, and analytic language program. As many of you know already, our students enjoy learning about the myths, culture, and history of the ancient world through participation in our annual Saturnalia celebration. Students demonstrate their success in learning through completion of the National Latin Exam each year, and our students compete with other enthusiastic Latin students from Massachusetts in academic and cultural events at Classics Day. This is our traditional Latin program. However, there's an additional Latin offering that is unique to RMHS, and that is the CP Latin Studies program. This program allows students to meet the 2-year foreign language graduation. This is a 2-year Latin language course designed to support a variety of language learners, particularly those with diagnosed language-based learning disabilities. Over the past 12 years, the Latin Studies curriculum has been developed and refined to meet the needs of students who, in many cases, have never studied a foreign language before. The course is differentiated, scaffolded, and provides the necessary supports for our students to be successful in learning a second language, in most cases for the very first time. In the Reading Public Schools, we currently only offer 2 languages, French and Spanish, in both middle schools. And a number of students there do not study any language at all, largely because of participation in special education programs. This has a significant impact on the overall Latin enrollment, as students in 8th grade generally opt to continue the language they have started in middle school and frequently are discouraged from changing to Latin or to the other spoken language. The students who do not take any language in the 7th or 8th grade could enroll in Spanish 1, a CP class at the high school. However, for the last several years, we have not actually offered a French 1 CP class at the high school. The population of students enrolled in Latin studies is unique in the foreign language department. Nearly every single student in this class has a diagnosed learning disability and receives supports through special education or accommodations through Chapter 504. The curriculum of Latin studies is designed to meet these needs. All projects are scaffolded, and all rubrics are structured to meet the needs of students with executive function challenges, for example. All quizzes are differentiated so that students needing word banks or modified formats, for example, will have that built into the assessment. The classes generally are either co-taught or supported by a paraprofessional. By the nature of this class, the small group setting is an essential component of the students learning in the classroom and when taking assessments. Further, because of the small size of these classes, we get to know our students as very well as we cycle through the two-year sequence with our kids. These are the things our Latin student, our Latin program provides, but our students get far more out of Latin than this. Statistics show the value of studying Latin for improving SAT and GRE scores. Approximately 60% of the English language is derived, vocabulary is derived from Latin roots. In addition to the benefits in building vocabulary, students come to understand grammar in both Latin and English far better than they generally do in other classes. Research has shown that Latin study trains students in abstract thinking and is a model for interdisciplinary study. I urge you not to cut elements of the Latin program. We have students who have risen to the challenge for 2 or 3 years, who have been expecting to complete the rigorous Latin honors program and to move to competitive colleges. If Latin honors, a single combined honors course of advanced Latin literature, were to be eliminated, that one class would be a loss of 2 levels. We have students as well who have begun the Latin study sequence and are working hard to understand the fundamentals of foreign language instruction for the very first time. These students are hoping to meet their foreign language requirement by having a 2-year sequence that will allow them to meet that need, their graduation requirement. I strongly believe that cutting elements of the Latin program, although cost-saving in the short term, will reduce the opportunities we offer our students and will deny future students the benefit of a meaningful and supportive foreign language option that currently does not exist in any other place at RMHS. I appreciate your time.
Thank you. Certainly appreciate an educator's perspective on that, and I know that the students think very highly of you.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that, Mr. Robinson.
Yes.
Can I ask a question to that? Is that okay?
Yeah.
Sorry. I meant to ask this question the other night. I just want to understand this cut in the budget.
I don't know it yet.
The students that are currently taking Latin, so the current freshman class, will we continue their Latin through graduation? Will they have the opportunity to continue through graduation? And does it also mean then that the incoming freshman class will not have the opportunity to take Latin?
I mean, that's something, my understanding is that our goal is to make sure that students that are already in the program continue with their sequence. In terms of the different variables about how it works out with the beginning year of Latin or with Latin studies, I think there's different variables that we need to look at with that, so I'm not prepared to answer that tonight.
I think that we'll deliberate all of the aspects of the budget, and certainly take Ms. Mahoney's comments in thought when we do that.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Yes.
Can I very brief report on the?
We were going to do reports.
Okay.
Now. I was going to ask Alex to
okay.
go first.
As I said on Monday, the Martin Luther King celebration is this Monday. And the choruses at the high school will be performing, and also the GSA and A World of Difference will be running the celebration. And also, on a similar note with Mrs. Mahoney, there's been a lot of talk about the Latin program between the students this week, and nobody is happy about it right now. And I've been taking Latin for 3 years, and I feel like it would benefit you to hear my opinion quickly. I've had both Ms. Mahoney and Mrs. Irons in these past 3 years, and Latin has been my favorite class since freshman year. And the announcement on Monday really shocked me, and it's really hard for me to explain how much, like to put into words, how much I love this class and how much it means to me and how important I think it is. Some general reasons like that I love Latin class, it's because the actual language, because it's so complex, and it's like, why do the Romans need so many endings for so many words, and we have to memorize charts and everything? But it's great. It's very interesting. Then there's the mythology piece. I mean, the Roman gods and goddesses are very interesting, and it's very fun to debate the logic about the tales that we read, that we translate. We also learn about the daily life of the Romans and how advanced the Roman Empire was. And we have two of the best teachers in the high school who are very passionate about the subject and about watching and helping their students to learn and grow and succeed. In class, it's very fun debating the logic of the myths, dressing up like the Roman gods and goddesses in togas for Saturnalia, and singing songs to memorize charts and different Latin pieces. And Latin really isn't a dead language anymore, as many people say it is. Yes, it's not spoken aloud, but it's the basis for the other languages we teach at the high school, French and Spanish. And it's a central part of science, especially medicine, and law as well. And like Mrs. Mahoney said, so many of the vocabulary from Latin translates to English. So I really hope the Latin program doesn't get cut, and I hope hearing my opinion helped. So thank you.
Thank you. Just a quick, I was at the Board of Selectmen meeting the other night along with two of my peers, and it's I found it to be very interesting and important that, as long with people watching the school budget, that you also attend the Board of Selectmen meeting and really follow that. It's a town-wide effort that we're going to be taking on, or that we need to explore, and I think all of the pieces together really to have as much information as possible when we're talking about, you know, a possible override or ways we can improve the town. I think it's important to attend those meetings as much as you can.
Thanks.
I have nothing.
Just to add on about the Martin Luther King Day, I have a huge thank you to say to community businesses who have stepped forth to help us with this event. So Honeydew Donuts at the Rotary and Bagel World in Reading, they are both going to be providing delicious breakfasts. So this event is free, and I think people know how delicious their food is. Reading Cooperative Bank, thanks for providing the water. And Market Basket has actually also given us a gift certificate to help with the expenses. And Anthony's Roast Beef is providing pizza for the Metco Elementary School choir, that chorus that will be singing. So they're rehearsing on Friday, tomorrow. And Anthony's is going to provide them with pizza so that they don't have to go into their cars into traffic hungry. But just the point that this is a huge effort by so many groups in our community, and Reading Community Singers, as well as the high school. We have a spoken word poem that will be sung. I can't go into all of them. We also have an activist from Rhode Island who's worked with the Hispanic community by mentoring students who said, no, this isn't impossible. Yes, the Hispanic population can succeed and be powerful, and now his people are leaders in the legislature and in business, and he will come talk to us as well. So I hope people can come. 9:30 breakfast, 10 o'clock program, over by hopefully 11:30. Thank you. And a lot of community organizations will have exhibit tables, so you'll see Martin Luther King's dreams in action, because Martin Luther King said the most important question is, what are we doing for others? And there are so many community groups doing things for others. And not all of them, but some of them will be at our program on Monday. So please come and bring your kids. Thank you.
Swip, sorry, not last but not least.
Yeah. So thank you, Mr. Chairman.
So I just wanted to maybe say a couple of things that I think are really important. So last school committee meeting, we were focused on the budget, the overview, the administrative area, and the regular day. And today it's student services,
special ed
district wide. And Tuesday night was the selectmen's meeting, and the town manager presented an overview that I think everyone in our community should look at that overview and see that overview presentation. I know that the RCTV coverage probably wasn't good enough. I'm trying to encourage the town manager to basically go into studio and do the presentation, and we should be perhaps thinking of doing something similar for Dr. Daugherty with the school budget. But we need people to really be engaged, and what you have to realize is the pain that the two people who spoke at the beginning of this meeting are talking about sounds exactly like the pain that we were in 13 years ago, because we waited too long to do an override. This budget is going to be extremely difficult for us, no doubt. And while we're talking about Latin, because that's what's on the list, we could, every I, every area, I was thinking about, is there an area that programmatically that we could cut that somebody wouldn't be in pain and hurt about? And the only one I could come up with was multivariable calculus was cut, I think, a year before last. Wasn't available to students. We didn't really get that much feedback. It still impacted students. It's still an issue that we can't offer what we would like to offer. It's going to be painful. Come be with us. Help us figure it out. But go to the financial forums. Go to the selectmen's meeting. Be engaged. Go to town meeting. Talk to your neighbors. This is my last thing. Not only are these cuts devastating and difficult for us to deal with as we make these budget decisions, we've lost sight of the things that this district really should have, which is, I just feel like we're hamstringed. We've always been just on that gosh darn cusp of being that truly excellent. We talk about great, good to great and excellent. We can't do it at, what are we, 305? Can't do it at 305. So I totally hear everything that you've said to us, and this is, I've been on too many of these budget sessions, I know, so has Mr. Robinson. So thank you.
Mr. Martin, do you want to? We have one report. Oh, I'm sorry.
I just wanted to mention that Coolidge's play starts tomorrow night, Alice in Wonderland, and that will be at the Performing Arts Center. So to keep that in mind, we have wonderful arts programs in this town, and that's one example.
Thank you.
Did you want to do the consent agenda, or go right into the presentation?
You're right. I just wanted to see if you had a report.
No reports.
Oh, does anybody want to remove anything from the consent agenda?
No.
Okay, Mr. Chair, move to approve the consent agenda as presented.
A second.
All those in favor? 5-0. Okay.
So I just wanted to begin by saying, obviously, Dr. Doherty was not able to be here tonight. He had, unfortunately, a personal matter that came up that he had to attend to tonight. But we told him that he didn't need to worry, that we could carry on with the presentations as scheduled. As we mentioned, Monday night, Dr. Doherty gave an overview of the FY 2017 recommended budget, and we looked specifically at two of the cost centers, administration and regular day. Continuing on then tonight, we have two more cost centers to look at. As Martha mentioned, special education and district-wide programs. Martha will be presenting on, and Carolyn Wilson will be giving some information about special education specifically. If it's okay with the committee, we were thinking as we went through the information tonight that we would sort of stop about midway after the special education in case there's any members of the community that had input or comments or things at that point. And then, of course, Martha could do the same after the district-wide programs. But, of course, the school committee, feel free to stop us at any time, ask any questions as we go along. You already mentioned, Mr. Robinson, we had a number of our own staff members, administrators, team chairs, department heads, special ed teachers, who else am I saying? So thank you all, network manager. Thank you all for attending tonight. So with that, I'll turn it over to Carolyn and...
Okay.
Yeah. Are you going from here, Carolyn?
I'm going to go right from here.
Right?
Yeah. Okay. That way we won't get in the way of the PowerPoint.
Yeah.
So I'm going to talk about the Special Education Cost Center. So special education falls in the Student Services Department here in Reading, and the goal of Student Services is really to provide high quality programs and services within the district for students who are identified with disabilities. We also support out of district placements for those students who require that. We are charged with following IDEA, which is the Individuals with Disability Education Act, as well as Section 504. And both of those laws really require us to think about providing a free, appropriate public education for students with disabilities. We have to be looking at how we can meet their needs in the least restrictive environment. And then there's also a piece of having a continuum of placement options. So students, our goal is for them to be in that least restrictive environment in the general education setting, but some students require more restrictive placements, some students require placement outside of the district. So really, this cost center focuses on how we meet the needs of those students. And really, the decisions are made at the building level. So IEP teams, which are made up of parents and sometimes the student, if they're 14 and older, and teaching staff, related service providers, make the decisions about goals, services, accommodations, and placements. So I think it's really important to just understand that those decisions are not made by me in my office, but they're made based on the individual students and by teams of people who really know that student best and know the programs within the schools. So here in Reading, we offer a number of in-district programs. What you'll see up here is just a description of the programs that we offer. So the Developmental Learning Center is for students identified on the autism spectrum, and it's located, currently we have fifth graders at Barrows, and then at Birch Meadow, Coolidge, and RMHS. For the FY17 year, all of the students will be moved out of Barrows and over to Birch Meadow. The DLC One program is a co-taught full inclusion model that's supported by a special education teacher, a classroom teacher, and then we also have paraprofessionals who support as needed in those classroom environments. The DLC Two program is a substantially separate program for students on the autism spectrum who require much more intensive instruction. In this program, students require very low staff to student ratios, sometimes one-to-one. We use principles of applied behavior analysis to teach those students, and some of those students need support in activities of daily living and have some safety or potentially medical issues that they require a lot of supervision by the adults. The Integrated Learning Program, or the ILP, is located at Wood End. It's for students identified with cognitive deficits, but some of those students may also have other medical needs. There's a focus at Wood End on a partial inclusion program, so a lot of those students participate in the general education setting as appropriate and determined by their IEP teams. But then if they require specialized instruction, that can happen in a smaller setting. Some of those students are working on activities of daily living and require the support of either paraprofessionals, special educators, related service staff to support them. They also may need one-to-one support if they might have medical or safety needs as they participate in our school community. The LLD program, or the Language Learning Differences program, is located at Eaton, Parker, and at the high school. This is a program for students identified with language-based learning disabilities. So those are students with average to above average IQ with a significant discrepancy in their academic functioning, either reading, writing, or math. And in those programs, we have the opportunity to provide a partial inclusion program with intensive remediation and reading. This program is modeled after the Landmark School, which I think many people are familiar with. This year, we are actually contracting with Landmark School to consult to these programs to help strengthen them so we can keep students here in our programs. And we have the opportunity in these programs to provide reading tutorials. We have small group ELA, small group math, and then at the high school level, we also provide a small group history in our language-based program. Our speech and language pathologists also support this program. And all of those services, as I go through these, are really dependent, remember, on the decisions of the IEP team. So not every student in each of these programs gets everything that's listed here. These are just sort of the complement of things we may provide, but the IEP team then would determine what the student's individual need is. Some students in, for instance, in the LLD program may be strong math learners, and so they participate in the inclusion setting for math, where other students may require small group math instruction. At each of our buildings, we do have learning centers, and these are staffed by special education teachers and paraprofessionals. The goal of the learning centers is to provide both support in the general ed setting and pull out specialized instruction as identified on students' IEPs. Some students participate in small group instruction for writing. Some students may need executive functioning support that might be supporting them in the general ed setting. So the learning centers have some flexibility in terms of their service model. The Student Support Program, SSP, and the Therapeutic Support Program, I'm going to kind of lump them together. Those are our programs for students with social and emotional impairments. Most of our students in those programs have mental health diagnoses and require therapeutic supports in order to access the curriculum day in and day out. Those programs are located at Killam, Coolidge, and the high school. And again, due to some of the behaviors or the mental health challenges, those students do require a high level of support in order to access the curriculum. We utilize special education teachers, social workers, school psychologists, paraprofessionals, occupational therapy, speech therapy, to really create a robust program to help support those students. The goal for next year, and I'll talk more about what we've been doing in our PLC work with these programs, is to just make it the therapeutic support program and just to rename and combine everything into therapeutic support program. We feel that better represents what we're doing, which is therapeutic support at all levels from elementary through high school. So as we move forward in the year, at the end of the year, I'll probably present out to you kind of some new names and some of the entrance and exit criteria and program descriptions that our staff are working on. The Compass program is located at Coolidge. That started last year. So Compass is a combination of some of the students who came out of our DLC program, the Autism Spectrum program, and some of the students who came out of our ILP program. These are students who have multiple disabilities. They may have medical disabilities, cognitive, neurological, and they're serviced in a substantially separate program that focuses on academics, life skills, and social skills. We have created this program to have, again, a low adult to student ratio because of the learning needs of the students in the program, as well as some of the safety and medical needs. We've been doing a lot of work to help students learn activities of daily living. They have a small kitchen, they have a oven, they have a microwave and sink in their classroom, so they're working on some of those skills. And we also have been increasing their opportunities for community trips. They also, I believe, are still going to the Y on a regular basis. So they're going out, you know, walking next door to the YMCA and doing some community pieces. So they, I think they're most recently, they're going to be going to the police station or fire station. So they try to do a lot of community safety work with the students and teach the skills in the real environment. And then finally is our newest program, the POST program, providing opportunities for successful transition, which we started this year, which we were very excited about. It's our partnership with the Wakefield Public Schools for our population of 18 students who are 18 to 22. So as you know, we are required to provide services for students until their 22nd birthday if they're not able to meet our graduation requirements and pass the MCAS. So this program really focuses on a vocational and transition activities. The students are learning, working with a recreational therapist to identify leisure and recreation activities that they like to do. Those students also have Y memberships because once you, you know, move on from high school, the way you go and work out is you go to your local Y or a gym, so they are going to the YMCA. They are currently participating in interns at the Rise. They're interning at the Rise Preschool. We also have them at PAWS, and they are at Full Circle Earth, which is an organic farming location in Beverly. So we are looking to increase internship opportunities, but this so far has been a great start to the year. We've also really loved our collaboration with Wakefield because what we've been able to do is expand the social network of our students. So many of these students have been together for a very long time here in Reading Public Schools, and now they have the opportunity to meet some new peers in a neighboring community that they may not have met previously. So we've seen some nice friendships developing in our students, and what's really been nice this year too is we have a van. That's part of the program, so they are out in the community a lot. So we've been very excited about what's happening in that program. They've also been supporting us with some clerical work in our offices, so which has been a great help. All right, so those are the programs. So as we've talked about in all the presentations, the work we do in each cost center is really connected to the goals that we have as a district. So you'll see the items that are bolded are the things that are really related to the special education cost center. Some of the other drivers are the Walker report that we had reviewed earlier this year. Last year, Walker Associates came and did a full program review of our special education programs in the district. So I wanted to just review some of the things that we have done based on those recommendations and some of the things, unfortunately, that we're not able to do because of some of the fiscal constraints. So for this school year, the 2015-2016 school year, we restructured contracted services to hire our own board certified behavior analyst. This has made a huge difference in supporting our students in our DLC program, our ILP, our Compass, and our POST program. This allows us to have a consistent expert here on our school campus who can be responsive to both staff, parents, and any other needs that arise. And she really has added a lot to our work. She's also provided training for our paraprofessionals. She provides a lot of parent consultation, and it's just a great support for us. And it's nice to be able to have someone in-house who can help build the capacity of our staff. We've been really pleased with adding this position. And we very much, I've worked to very much protect her responsibilities, because we know that one FTE can in no way service our nine schools that we have, our preschool, our elementaries, middle, and high school. There is no way. So I have to very much work to protect and limit those responsibilities so she can be effective and that she'll stay with us. So last year, the other thing, this time last year, we talked a lot about the TSP-SSP program, and we had restructured a position to add a director of TSP-SSP. In the spring, after reviewing the recommendations from Walker, we really felt strongly that we needed another team chair instead of this director position. We felt that the team chair position would allow us to support all of our programs in the district and not just TSP-SSP. The findings in the Walker report were really kind of clear that we were experiencing so much turnover in that position. It was impacting both our relationships with parents and our relationships with staff, because there was a constant turnover in the team chair position. By increasing the FTEs that we have for team chair, we're able to make caseloads that are more manageable. The team chairs have more availability to both the staff and the parents, so it really helps for continuity. And the other piece we were able to do is to add a 0.5 out-of-district coordinator who works exclusively on out-of-district cases, so that in previous years that had been sort of an add-on to someone's job, or maybe the director was doing some, or you know, the director of preschool was doing some, so it was kind of piecemeal. So now we have someone who is part-time, who really dedicates her schedule to managing our out-of-district cases. She also can work closely with the team chairs in the different buildings to see if a student is ready to transition back and knows our program. So we're happy to have that stability in our team chairs. Some of the other recommendations that we just talked about was the POST program, which was a huge piece of our change, because there was a feeling that we really weren't offering what we needed to for our 18 to 22 population. The other things we've worked on that haven't had a monetary impact is we are improving our transition process for students with disabilities from level to level. So when students are transitioning from pre-K to K, from elementary to middle, middle to high school. So we're really looking at how we transition students and how we communicate with parents. The other piece we've been doing, as I mentioned, is we're working on our program descriptions and our entrance and exit criteria. There's a lot of reasons for this. We need to have some transparency with our families so they really understand what our programs have to offer. And as I said, it's not a checklist of this is what every student gets, but this is kind of a variety of services that we do offer. We may have to offer something different because an IEP team determines something different. But we want to make sure that families can come into meetings and feel like they understand what we're talking about and understand what programs we have to offer. It's also important because, and we'll talk a little bit later, that we do have some students who are tuitioned into our district, into some of our programs, because other communities are looking for programs that maybe they don't have to offer. So by having clear program descriptions, we can also share that with other communities who may be interested in tuitioning in and sending their student to our program. We've also, there were some concerns in the Walker report about space at Reading High School where the TSP was located, and we did rectify that and move their space for this school year. Some of the things we haven't really been able to address, which you'll see the top one is space. We do have a space issue. And the challenge for our in-district programs is that some of those programs are in shared spaces or spaces that really aren't appropriate or smaller than they need to be. So as we think about running quality programs, we do have to think about space because we need to make sure that they're appropriate for the population. Some of the students have a lot of equipment, and we need space to store that. So we really have to be thinking about the space needs. The second bullet is about the structure of the student services office. The Walker report indicated that we really need to think about, because there's been a lot of turnover in my position, the director position, we need to look at the structure of student services. I think until we have stability in our team chairs and really see how that model is working, we really can't evaluate what that structure needs to look like at this point. And there are some fiscal implications to that component. The last bullet is the work that we're doing as an administrative team. We're really looking at our co-teaching model and really trying to come to an understanding as an administrative team as to what is co-teaching, how do we use this to meet the needs of students, and what is it look, what is that model? How does it look in our different schools? It's just not something we've spent a lot of time. We talk about co-teaching. We have co-teaching in the DLC. We have some co-teaching at the middle school. We have co-teaching at the high school. But I think if you asked every principal, they would probably give you a different definition. So we're really trying to work as an administrative team. We're reading some articles and really coming up with that definition. So that's still in process. So now I'll turn it over to Martha to do some of her...
the numbers. So before we get to the numbers, we just want to talk a little bit about what the major functions are, what expenses are covered in this cost center. So the curriculum, the director of student services, clerical support for that office, tutoring services, software licenses. Currently we use SEMS Tracker to track all of our students that are on IEPs and 504s. SEMS Tracker was recently sold, so we'll be changing our software provider next year. Actually, we'll be transitioning in Q4 of this year to a new system, which we're actually both excited about.
Yes, we are.
Because it's more robust, and we're looking forward to it. Supplies and materials to support the director's office. Curriculum leaders, which are at the RISE level. Instructional coordinators are our team chairs. Oops, did that not?
Yeah. Is that software just for the students on IEPs and plans, or is it?
It's for IEPs and 504.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, how come it's not clicking now?
Not working for you. Oh, something is, there's an error message on your...
on the computer?
Yeah.
Right?
Uh-oh.
Oh, dear.
It's not a good thing there.
Okay.
It's not plugged in, maybe.
Well, we're done.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming. Yeah, it worked for you. Thanks.
I know, I got through mine. I have more slides at the end.
It'll be fine.
Okay. Let's see if we can get it to go.
There we go. Okay, great.
Thank you.
So another major cost in this area is instructional. So obviously our teachers, our different therapists, both physical, OT, PT. Nursing staff is kind of an anomaly in there. We don't really have nursing staff in this area. But if you look at some of the charts in the budget book, there was nursing about 5 years ago, so that will kind of fall off. So that's why that's still there as an expense. There's really not dedicated nursing in special ed. Paraprofessionals, extended year programs, which is what our offerings to students on IEPs that would have a loss of learning if they didn't continue into the summer. So it's a program that we offer in the summertime. Consultative services, contractual services, substitutes for paraprofessionals. So for special ed paraprofessionals, that's budgeted in here. The substitutes for all of our teachers are in our regular day budget. And then some small professional development expenses are also included in this area. You know, again, instructional material and equipment, any related software materials or media items for SPED classrooms or our programs, any adaptive equipment or technology, testing assessments in the psychological services area that supports our district-wide evaluator. and middle school and high school social workers, as well as supplies and materials for those offices.
No, okay. It's coming up again.
It's, right. I'm getting an error again. I don't know. Do you want me to come look? Do you want to close it?
I think okay. You've given us the error number.
Okay. All right, so another expense in this area is transportation services. As you know, any student that's placed out of district, we provide transportation to them, as well as some in-district transportation. There are a number of students in district that are on IEPs that we provide transportation as well. Our collaborative dues, we are members of two collaboratives, the SEAM and North Shore Education Consortium. Medicaid claiming services, this is a small expense in this budget, but it's a big revenue generator for the town. So on a quarterly basis, we file Medicaid claims, so insurance claims for services that are provided to students that are on IEPs, and we typically get between $100,000 and $200,000 in revenue. It goes directly to the operating budget all revenue goes to the operating budget. So it doesn't come back to the school budget, but we get a piece of the operating budget, as you know. So, and then there's tuition expense, our collaborative residential and private day tuition expenses.
Right, as well. Do you want me to tap in on the tuition piece? I just want to talk a little bit about out-of-district costs.
Yeah.
So one of the things I think that's really important in thinking about this area is that private special education schools, both day and residential, have the opportunities at least probably every 3 years to go for what's called program reconstruction. This is an opportunity for them to explain to the Department of Education why they have different needs and need to have a rate increase. So we, as a purchaser of services from private special education schools, receive notice and we can attend a hearing. In my tenure, I haven't seen a reconstruction denied, and oftentimes we can't anticipate how great that rate increase will be. So that's one factor in taking a look at out-of-districts. So they do have every year, private special education schools have a rate increase no matter what, but then some schools go for program reconstruction, and so then we see a larger increase on that end. The other piece that is kind of the unpredictable in this area is that we do have students who move into our community who have been placed by their previous district in an out-of-district placement. And if they move into our community, we are responsible for paying for that placement. So we have had students move in, and so we have to make sure that we're somewhat prepared for that, but you can't always anticipate what that will look like year to year. I mean, we also have students who move out.
I will say that this one part of the budget consumes a lot of Carolyn and my time in late October, early November, mm-hmm. where we really go through all the students that are currently placed, mm-hmm. and we look on the horizon for who have, whether there are mediations coming up or people or parents who have unilaterally placed students where we may become responsible mm-hmm. For a tuition bill. So we really do thoughtfully try to look at tuition because we do recognize that it's an accommodated cost and it comes out of the overall budget right away to be covered 100%. So we really want to be thoughtful about what we put in there. Legal services, this, and I don't want to rush, any questions on tuitions?
I haven't had a chance to get through all this yet, but what I think we said the other night, what's the circuit breaker at now? Is it
75%,
and our circuit breaker went up year over year by about $90,000. So last year, when we were developing the FY16 budget, we took a loss of almost $230,000 in circuit breaker based on our claims, and this year, from last year to this year, we've gone back up about $90,000, so, which is helpful when developing the budget. And if you recall, we have budget certainty when it comes to circuit breaker. We're in a very good position where we are allowed by statute to hold circuit breaker for a year. And so the award that we're getting this year for FY16, we have held and we will use next year in FY17. So it's a little, sometimes it can be confusing when you're talking about it, but the FY16 award is $90,000 more than the FY15, which is what we're using this year to support the budget. Mm-hmm. So if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. So we're in a good position for budget certainty when it comes to circuit breaker.
Yes.
I had a question on the psychological services, because when we talked about regular day the other night, we talked about, I remember that we said there was a certain piece of the regular daylight item that also, that covers the full expense for all students, including special education, but yet these are different. So I was wondering if you could just clarify that.
These are the social workers. So the school psychologists are on the regular day budget. Mm-hmm. The social workers are on the special education budget.
Okay.
But they all get captured. They all get captured in the DESE code 280. So
okay. The only psychologist that's captured in here is our district-wide evaluator, who evaluates only for special education at the elementary level. All she does is special education evaluations. She doesn't support any general education students.
Okay.
So when you see district-wide evaluator, that's who's captured there. Everyone else are our social work support for our therapeutic program.
Okay, so even though it says psychology services, it's
the social workers are in this budget, other than that evaluator, and the other psychologists are in the regular day.
Yes. Yes, because they support the general population.
And then what about the contracted psychological counseling? So that's something specifically then for SPED, mm-hmm. specific services?
Mm-hmm. Correct.
Okay, probably related to student needs. Okay, thank you.
Carolyn, can you just talk a little bit about the new social worker position?
I'm going to.
Okay.
It's coming. There's a couple of slides.
It's coming.
Legal services, these are legal services student related. So the other legal services that we have are in the administrative cost center with regard to employee relations. This is all anything that has to do with a student handbook, harassment, bullying, discipline, anything.
Ed.
That all ends up in legal services in the special education budget. So to talk a little bit about the increases in this cost center, obviously, you know, the step and column changes, if applicable, and COLA increases for teachers, paras, and secretaries are in here. We talked a little bit about the increases for known tuitions, anticipated and known students that are already placed out of district, and then the 1.0 FTE social worker that Carolyn will talk about a little bit in more detail in a moment. It's important to highlight one of the decreases, because when you look at the budget table, it looks like special education is going up 7.7%. It's really misleading, because in the FY16 budget, we increased the offset to the revolving account for special education tuition by over $250,000 to help mitigate the circuit breaker loss. That was a one-year only fix. So next year's revolving fund offset is $335,000 less than this year's. So when you look at the overall expenditures, it looks like it's spiking up next year, and it really isn't. We had the benefit of a much larger offset in this year's budget. Does that make sense? I just want to make sure that so that's a big part of a decrease that's driving this. And then there's a small reduction of 0.4 speech and language pathologists, which I'm going to let Carolyn talk a little bit about the staffing changes.
Yep. So these are our two staffing changes. As we said, the 1.0 FTE social worker for the therapeutic or SS pre program at Killam, and then the decrease in 0.4 speech and language pathologist. So I'm going to kind of talk first about the social worker piece. So in all of our therapeutic programs at the middle and high school, we have special education teachers along with some sort of counseling staff attached to those programs. As I mentioned, the students in those programs have mental health needs and really need the support of counseling staff. At Killam, the model is we have one special education teacher who works with students grade K to 5. With paraprofessionals. We do have one school psychologist for the entire building who also supports the students in that program. So she is responsible for testing of students with special education needs, as well as providing tier 1 and tier 2 supports for any of our general education students, servicing any IEP or 504 students who are not in the program, plus the program. So the need for a social worker is great in that program in order for us to support what we want our vision in that program to be, to provide therapeutic support. We have seen students leaving that program to go to out-of-district placements because we really don't have the intensity of therapeutic supports. So by having a social worker, we can have really consistent therapeutic supports in the program. Someone who can dedicate time to providing the group work as well as individual counseling that students may need. At the other levels, we're able to provide more consistent CBT and DBT groups that really are therapeutic for students. They also are able to provide more individual counseling. The goal would be for the social worker to be a point person to coordinate with collaterals, being able to speak to the outside counselor, having the opportunity to speak to potentially a psychiatrist, to the parent, to be able to coordinate services as needed, because those are things that come up in a therapeutic program all quite consistently. We also need, when we have a program like this, like our other programs, we need to be able to also provide training and support for both our paraprofessionals and our classroom teachers. So really, this social worker will help increase our training and consultation capacity in that building. And it would also allow us to really delineate the role between the special educator and the social worker. The special educator will very much be able to now focus, yes, on behavior, but also on the academic supports that those students need. And our social worker will be able to do the therapeutic and behavioral supports as well. They can really be a team. And that's what we see happening at our high school level and our middle school level, that we don't, you know, although our school psychologist at Killam is phenomenal, I think that we have stretched as far as we can go on that end. The school-wide benefit is, as I said, will allow the school psychologist to play the role that we really want, which is that support for all students in the building, providing our tier one and tier two supports that, you know, become last on the plate, unfortunately, when you need to be meeting IEP needs or responding to students who have mental health needs. We also want to make sure there's consultative services, not just for the students in the program, but to teachers around any student. If a teacher is struggling and the school psychologist can be a support, we want them to be available. And in the current model, there just isn't that availability. That consultation, again, becomes something that's optional because you have to respond to the students that are in front of you. So this program would really, this position would really allow us to strengthen that program and really make it a much more viable program. We've also had a lot of turnover in our staffing at both that program and at all of our therapeutic programs. So we really need to think about how those programs are staffed so that the staff in them feel supported, that they're not by themselves. And Killam is the program that has the least amount of staff in our district, so I think we really need to target the supports there to help them in that program. Are there any other questions about that?
Obviously confidential, but Al, do you, how you said we've lost students because of this?
Right.
What's, how many?
I don't want to share too much because I do think it, you know, could, it's not a huge number, so I do think we could risk, you know, sharing confidential information. But we have lost students. We've also had to place students in what we call an extended evaluation outside of the district to gather more information. So there have been costs associated with not having that.
Yes.
I think it's also noteworthy is to recognize that I think our teachers and you have been rising to this challenge. As our budgets get smaller, the load gets bigger. And I'm glad that we're recognizing this before we lose other good staff. The turnover that you mentioned is really a red flag. When teachers and professionals can't provide for the needs of the students they care about, it gets very difficult for them to stay in a situation where they can't succeed, where they want to and they can't. So I'm really pleased that you're looking at that way. I also wanted to recognize how hard it is.
Can I just, I wasn't referring to staff. I was referring to students.
The student, right.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Okay. Sorry, I know you were, but I was making that connection to staff as well because there had been turnover in the staff before you and before this time with this program, and I think it's important for us to recognize why. And it's not just about money. It's about enabling people to do the job that they want to do for the students and the district they care about. So, thank you.
All right. So then the last budget change is the reduction of 0.4 speech and language services. So the first bullet just really describes what speech and language services are in the district. And then you will see that what we are looking at is taking, we have 10.4 FTE. We had, like we had a typo, but now it's gone. So maybe this is a different version. So 10.4 FTE, reducing by the 0.4 would provide us with 10 FTE, which is one speech and language pathologist at each elementary, one at each middle school, one at the high school, and then we still have 1.0 FTE that can just be distributed where the need is, whether that is at RISE or in one of our other elementary schools. And one of the drivers in this is as we are shifting all of our DLC students to Birch Meadow, when the program was split, we had to really accommodate those needs between the two buildings. Now that the DLC will all be at Birch Meadow, it really changes that. The other piece that really we're looking to examine, and I've had a lot of conversations with principals, is looking at our master scheduling. So you'll see kind of some lists of next steps of things we need to do. One of the challenges we've been discussing at the elementary level is that a lot of our elementaries all create a schedule where everyone in the building is teaching the same thing at the same time. So from a special education perspective, not just for speech and language, but for all special educators, that can be really challenging to support a number of students. So I'm doing some work with the building principals around master schedules. There's a lot more resources than just me, but of how to put together schedules that are more conducive to allow us to better support students so that not everyone K to five is teaching math, and we expect our two special ed teachers to support in math across all those classes.
23 classes.
So some of this is a scheduling piece that we'll be working on. Others is the shift in where our students are. And then it's really going to be looking at groupings more in depth. So as I put in here, the best practice is that most students at the elementary should be in groups of 2 to 3 students who have targeted similar skills, and at the middle and high school level, 2 to 4 students with similar needs. So we really have to start looking at how students are being grouped and what that looks like. And sometimes the reasons they're not in groups has to do with schedule and not with student needs. So that's the level of analysis that we'll be doing as we make these changes. I'm feeling comfortable with caseloads and how we'll be able to service our students. I think some of it is on the responsibility of us as administrators to really look at those pieces that seem to get in the way for all of our service providers. It's more of a scheduling logistics piece. So, and now it's you.
Now back to me. Let's see if it works.
It does work. Yeah.
So we want to talk a little bit about the historical and not historical, but the current enrollment. So this was as of October 1st. We wanted to delineate grade level and by program. So you can see the Compass program, which is at Coolidge, has 4 students in it. They're grade 7 currently. The DLC program, which we mentioned is transitioning, grade 5 is at Barrows this year. It'll all be at Birch Meadow next year. You can see the number of enrollment in that program. The total enrollment in our programs right now is 191. It was 197 last year. I think for next year we might want to include a grid that starts to show the trend. Now that we have some data in a few years, because we've been adding programs and transitioning them, but I think for next year, we'll start to put a trend graph in there so you can see where the enrollment has been moving. And you can also see the POST program has been added to this list of offerings. When it comes to our overall special education enrollment, we did see a slight downtick this year from a high of 809. To 791 in terms of total number of students on IEPs. Again, this is as a point in time because we're always receiving referrals. We have people move in, move out, that sort of thing. So as of October 1st, it was 791. which represented about 18% of our total student population. We're a little, yeah. Sounds like robotics, yeah. The state average in FY14-15 was 17.1, and we were at 18.4. We've consistently trended pretty close to or a little bit above the state average. And our out-of-district student placements, we've had a peak, couple of peak years there where we had 73. We had a low of 50, and we've been in the 60s pretty consistently for the last couple of years.
Out of district, are they included? Is that 791 number inclusive of the 64 out of district and the 191 in programs?
No, they wouldn't be in the 191 in programs. They would be in the 791.
So what I'm trying to get at is what's the total number of kids being serviced through special education?
Yeah, anyone on an IEP is in the 791, whether they're here or somewhere else. So yes.
But they wouldn't be in the programs because the 191 number is just in district.
So, but that 191
is baked into the 791.
They would be baked into the 791.
That's
yes.
Exactly what I wanted to know. Yeah. Thank you. Yes.
Again, we like to look at our historical spending trends when it comes to special education. As you can see on the far left, we've got our in-district instruction expenses. That covers teaching, materials, things along that nature. And you can see the last few years, 2012, 13, 14, we've been steadily increasing. And you can also see that for the out-of-district tuitions, we've been declining in that same period of time, while our overall percentage of budget has remained pretty consistent. And that really is a testament to the programs that we're developing in district and keeping kids here. So. We also have trended slightly above the state average in terms of percentage of operating budget, but not significantly. We're very close to the state average when it comes to percentage of our budget.
So just on that chart, I mean, what you're saying, this is, you feel good because if the a greater level of outer district is more money. So in mm-hmm. terms of, you know, this shift, I mean, overall it's still the 21.6%, but if we, you know, continue to have to put more students out of district, it's a bigger, per student cost. So
exactly.
You're sort of saying that that's how you're looking at that balance.
Exactly.
I think the other piece is the benefits having the students in our mm-hmm. community is huge mm-hmm. and really, we want students to be able to participate in our community, be here, interact with their siblings, you know, do those community events that we have. And when we send students out of district, there is a cost of them not being part of the Reading community. So that's the other thing.
Yeah, I think one of the things we talked about with the budget parents earlier mm-hmm. this evening was when they go out of district, they're no longer with their peer group. Mm-hmm. They're only with kids that are with disabilities on IEPs, and they're mm-hmm. not in their community anymore. And so we do our best to keep them in district. Mm-hmm. Special education staffing, the chart goes back FY13 through budgeted FY17. Really the only change in staffing that you'll see is down at the bottom here where you've got the 2.6 going to 3.6 FTEs, and that's what we talked about earlier about adding a social worker, and then the 0.4 reduction on speech and language pathologist. Those are really the two big changes in this chart.
With the speech language pathologist line, with the number going down, why is the dollar amount going up?
Is that all steps?
Steps and COLAs. I would have to look at it and see what turnover we've had to see, and also look and see. There may have been an opening in the position in FY16, so the actual salary may be deflated because there was an open position for a period of time. So there could be a couple things contributing to that. Because mm-hmm. if you look at the budgeted amount of 801 versus 814, I think it might have been just an open, partially open position during the current year. But I'd have to look into that further, though. Thank you.
Carol, you probably just hit on it. I missed it. So we almost have
four, we're almost going to have four social workers, not, so what's the 0.6?
0.6.
We're at 3.6. Yeah. What, is that an additional?
Oh, I think we have a 0.6 at the high school.
Okay, so we'll have
attached to
three
the
plus three full plus the 0.6.
Yes.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And actually, I think that's the one that's open right now, isn't it?
No, that's full now.
That is full.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, but one of those, remember, is the district-wide evaluator too, right? No, she's in another
a different
place.
Line.
Sorry. So, yeah. So those will be two of them are at the high school, 2.6.
Again, as I spoke earlier, trying to preface this, when you look at this, it does appear that there's a significant increase in special education, and I just want to caution you that this is somewhat misleading because it's a $335,000 offset reduction in FY17. So the FY16 budgeted offset is $335,000 more than what's in FY17, and so that's contributing to the appearance that special education is rising at a significant pace. That was a one-time budget offset from the special education tuition revolving fund. It was twofold. It was to help bring that revolving fund back into, you know, there were a few, the presentation that the town accountant and I did over the summer where the revolving fund had been growing and we hadn't been taking offsets that we needed to. So it was almost a one-year correction and it helped mitigate the loss in circuit breaker for FY16. So.
I have a question about the revolving funds.
Mm-hmm.
So when I was looking through this, what I was realizing is what we need to find money. We're trying to do this without hurting students. And I know that we have been able to figure out that some of our programs tap into programs that are positions that are funded by across the district. And I was wondering about the nurse. I know that you said 5 years ago it was a position that was funded within special ed,
mm-hmm.
but if we have school nurses that are also used by the special ed program, is there a way that part of that nursing could be paid for through the revolving funds?
No, the revolving fund that we have for student tuition is really for students that are paying to come here to attend a specific program. So we can use it for that purpose. So to improve the programs, the Compass program, to improve the language learning program, that's where the students are currently are tuitioned in. And so we really have to spend the money to offset those programs, not for general expenses. So that's where, in this year's budget, where we took the offsets from the revolving fund, it's two schools that have those students that are paying tuition here. That's where we can offset the teaching cost, the material cost, from having a student from out of district paying to come here.
And my question was, at those schools, where those students who are paying tuition need access to nurses?
I'd have to look into it more.
Just an idea. The other piece was the secretary who's doing the secretary role. Is that something, does that secretary also deal with the students that are coming in for the specific programs paying tuition? Is that
secretary is here to support Carol and the secretary that's, mm-hmm. I think that's the one you're asking about.
Right, but I'm wondering if part of what she's doing is also the tuition.
I'd have to look into
it. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks.
In terms of special education by function, almost 60% of our special education budget goes to instructional services, which includes teachers, materials, therapists, things along that nature. 27% is for tuition. Another almost 8.5% is for transportation. That's for all transportation, both in-district and out-of-district. And then another 5.7% for all other that aren't in those three categories. My near and dear to me, the DESE chart of accounts. So when we capture our expenses, we capture them by in accordance with the DESE category for function categories. And so here is the list of function categories for special education. I'll highlight a few significant changes where you can see along this line, the specialist, that is the line that we typically take the revolving fund offset for, so that's why you see that significant jump.
Mm-hmm.
So our salaries are not going up by that much, it's our offset is going down. The other jump up that you see is in instructional coordinators, and that's where we, what did you say, I lost my notes, that's where we added the 0.4 for team chairs. Another one here that is of some interest is the $24,000, the change, because it's a big reduction, a 92% decrease for other instructional services. In FY16, we've had an open position at the high school for reading specialist, and we've been kind of backfilling just to provide those services to those students that need it. And we do anticipate the position being filled, so it's not budgeted for here for next year because we anticipate an FTE in that position. And then the last one to point out is here, psychological services. So you can see the increase there. That's the additional FTE that we're requesting for the SSP program, the social worker.
And legal, why is legal?
Legal, we tried to base it kind of on our trends. We had a peak year of 93,000 in FY14. We had a low point of 69,000. Last year was 67. We budgeted 69, but we were optimistic that we will be able to come in at 77,000. So that was where Dr. Doherty and I went through the budget and really tried to look at where can we, find the twos and the threes to offset other expenses, other known increases.
That is an increase. So that's not an offset.
It's an increase, but it's based on trend.
So are you saying, though, that looking at FY16, do you feel like we're going to exceed that? Is that why,
I do think that we're going to exceed 69,000.
Right, so you're looking at what that trend is so far, saying that it would be, to budget at 69 again, would be below what we're going to actually end the year at, potentially.
Correct.
Big jump in that. I missed that.
So when this rolls up, it includes any offsets, any revolving fund offsets. So the offset that we included in FY16 into FY17 has decreased by $335,000.
So what is the offset, though?
It's the special education tuition.
No. I'm sort of looking where are the offsets in here to get my to see what they are, the amounts.
What's the amount?
The amount for this year's budget for special education is $215,000.
Which is, you said 300 and...
It's 335,000 less than what it was last year.
Oh, at the 215, it's 335. Okay.
Yeah. From that tuition revolving fund.
Mm-hmm.
And just a clarification on that. At some point, I think towards the end of all these presentations, we're going to go through all the revolving funds.
We are. That's the Thursday night.
All right.
Yes. We'll go through grants. We'll go through facilities, grants, and revolving funds next Thursday.
Yes. So just to clarify that, other instructional services. So I understood you said, so we have an FTE there. Does that mean, was the 24,000 contracted services?
Yes.
Okay. It was contracted services.
Yeah. Because there was an opening FTE.
And we didn't fill it, but we needed to provide the services to fulfill the law.
While the position was open. Yes.
Okay. Right. It's not, right. So because those are special ed IEP services, those needed to be contracted and paid for.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you for walking us through the increases. There's also some decreases, a significant decrease in professional development, text and materials, instructional equipment, and general supplies. Can you talk through a little bit of the methodology between those? Those seem like low numbers relative to what's been spent in the past in those areas.
I guess you're correct. I mean, we had budget constraints, and when Carolyn and I were developing the budget, we looked for where we could reduce and tighten the belt on certain things and use, I'll use professional development as an example. our historical trend here is 25,000, 28,000. If you go back to FY13, we spent 19,000, just close to 20,000. We went back to that level, hoping that we'll be able to utilize some of our grants or mm-hmm. maybe get some look for other funding for mm-hmm. professional development. I'm sorry,
that's
what was
contradictory
some?
To the answer we just got on legal. Mm-hmm. You know, we're trying to true that up to what it was, and that
I think the piece on legal, the only thing I would say is that like some of our other expenses, it fluctuates. And as Martha mentioned, that those are things like our reviewing our handbooks, anytime we have policy changes that are at the school level, that's where all those expenses are captured. And sometimes it's unpredictable. We don't know if there's a discipline issue that arises, we may need to consult with legal counsel. So whereas professional development, we can have a little more control over what we can offer and what we can't offer, unfortunately. But where legal service, sometimes it's not an option for us to not reach out to legal counsel because of some of the incidents that arise. Mm-hmm. So I think that's the difference.
Yeah.
Yes.
So in this category that Ms. Borowski is asking about, so then sort of the instructional equipment, that level is your, again, sort of going back to actually below 2013, but that is that a little bit more controllable than sort of, what about like therapeutic, when it's a therapeutic, is it equipment or services, then you would have to provide that. Is that in, are those kinds of things in the therapeutic equipment and the therapeutic services? So that if there was a student that required that, that's not in this instructional equipment line item, it would really be in the therapeutic services?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes.
And the equipment is in there too?
More things that they require as a result of IEP.
Right, because once that's determined, you have to provide that.
Right.
So
yes.
Whereas this instructional equipment is something that's, you maybe have a little bit more variable control over.
Yes.
And some of the changes that we've tried to do in the last couple of years when it comes to instructional equipment, Carolyn and I have been trying to make sure that it follows the student. So that if we're buying something for a student, it doesn't become part of a class, it follows the student. And I'm trying to think of a good example of one where.
Any type of communication device that a student may need or a piece of technology, that it's not something that stays at the school, that we purchased it for a particular student as a result of their IEP, so it continues on. So that when they do those transitions, let's say from elementary to middle, mm-hmm. like that piece of equipment doesn't stay at the elementary, and then they say, we need to buy another one. So we've done a lot of that. We also have a lot of students who require hearing equipment, mm-hmm. so we've done a lot of inventorying of that equipment and also making sure those things that can travel with the student do travel versus continually buying for the next level.
Were there other ones that you wanted to?
The other ones are relatively small mm-hmm. dollar.
That was it for special education. I don't know if there are any other questions on this category or if we wanted to. No? Okay.
Yeah.
Yes. I did have a question. I know that last year I asked about a grant writer and we were told that SEAM has a grant writer that we would have access to. Mm-hmm. Is that a resource that might help to fund anything that, I mean, for instance, the cut in professional development, is SEAM a resource that might be utilized so that if there is a professional development program that would benefit our staff in serving the needs better of our students, is that a resource?
I haven't utilized them, but I think when we go over grants, you'll hear more about one of the grants we have for professional development and mm-hmm. sort of the amount and how it really does help support a lot of our professional development. So when you see this amount, that's sort of the operating budget piece, but we do get a much larger grant from the Department of Education that supports professional development in the area of special education.
Because my concern was that we have, one of our main goals is to build capacity mm-hmm. of our staff and the mm-hmm. instruction of our students. And if we're lowering the professional development. I just want to be sure it's coming from somewhere else then.
And we've really tried to be targeted in our professional development, so similar to the model that Craig has been using in terms of coaching and building capacity, we've been doing the same thing in special education. As I mentioned, we've been using the Landmark School to help come in. They come in and do coaching. It's not a one-shot piece where people go to a training and then they leave and, you know, we're not applying it. It's an ongoing contract that we have with them. We're also working this year with SEAM and North Shore Consortium to do consultation and coaching to our therapeutic programs. So it's a monthly time that they have some coaching and support. And then we really targeted where our needs were. So for instance, in our DLC2 classroom and Compass, we sent some staff to a really specific training on verbal behavior and how to teach that, which was very targeted to their population. So we've really been strategic in the training we are providing so that it is something that our staff can come back and use right away. One of the things I found last year is, I think maybe as a new director, people were kind of testing the water and wanted to go to a lot of things, and now I have a better sense of what our needs are and how I can direct that professional development versus getting email requests on a daily basis about workshops and conferences. So I've really tried to direct where we're using that fund so we can target it to meet our needs.
And we had a parent from the special ed PAC that wanted to present.
Thanks, Alan. So my name's Kate Goldless, and a parent of Reading students, but just as I'm on the board of the current CPAC and just received an impact statement from a parent of a child who's currently receiving special education services, so I just wanted to share it for that parent. And it's actually something that Carolyn referenced from the Walker report in relation to a new hire of the certified behaviorist. So I'll just read the parent's statement. My child's transition into kindergarten was rough. Within the first 4 weeks of school, we were called to come pick them up or called down to the school for several emergency meetings. When the newly hired board-certified behavior analyst got involved, the phone calls stopped, the emergency meetings became non-existent, and my child finally settled into school. The difference was the behaviorist, and I was told I could use her name because it's a very positive Lisa Studer. My child had been lacking the appropriate support staff to help him through his anxiety and curb his behaviors. The behaviorist was exactly what our child needed. Having the permanent behaviorist on my child's team has been key with his quick turnaround and gaining success in just a few short weeks. My child is doing better than I could ever hope. Without the behaviorist Lisa Studer on our team, our child would have most likely placed out of district. Lisa was able to help teach the staff how to manage my son. She saved the town from having an additional out-of-district student. Unfortunately, one behaviorist can only be in one building at one time helping one child. Each building in the district can benefit from having a behaviorist on staff, or at least another one in town. Not only does the behaviorist support the students, but she also helps with staff training and parent guidance. She is instrumental in the success of the children in Reading, and the proof is in my child. My child's behavior has become so non-existent, they don't even collect data on it. I no longer get a weekly spreadsheet that tells me how many spikes of non-compliance or outbursts there were. Quite simply, there are none. My child's IEP goal was to sit for 2 to 3 minutes and do work. Last week, he did worksheets for 20 minutes. A behaviorist cannot and should not have to take on the entire district of children, their parents, and our staff. Having a behaviorist has made such a difference in our son's life. If you continue with having one behaviorist support the entire district, it will only hurt our kids in the long run and burn her out. So just wanted to say that. Thank you.
Too. It's been interesting to hear some of the stories, and particularly that one. A lot that we're talking about is targeted to the elementary level, like at Killam.
like a behaviorist working with elementary students. And I think that there are long-term costs that don't get captured in the budget. If you can attack problem behaviors or issues in kindergarten, first, second, third grade, as opposed to surviving them until middle school. Mm-hmm. So I think that there is a financial impact that's kind of impossible to capture, but we should be mindful that when we are targeting the elementary population, you really can be saving money for the community down the road, as well as it being the moral right thing to do.
Yes.
That actually relates to my question. Thank you for the segue. You talked a little bit about the Walker Report and its recommendation to have the district SSP and TSP program director, and how the team chairs have actually taken on some of that role. Mm-hmm. And when I was seeing that, my question is about the big picture, like what Mrs. Borowski was saying, where seeing some of the programs, some of the mental health challenges are there, and some might actually be exacerbated through the process of school. We have a behavior specialist, Sarah Bird, who's in a program, the Safe and Supportive Schools. We're acknowledging now how much pressure and anxiety can be generated through this process. So one of my concerns is getting the whole picture, like Mrs. Borowski was talking about, where starting from kindergarten, we're being very cognizant of the pressure that we're putting our children and their parents through. And how, if we have someone that has sort of that big picture in mind, mm-hmm. so that graph that we were shown, I think it was last week, where our special ed IEP numbers go like this, so they start out smaller in the mm-hmm. elementary school, yeah. go bigger in the middle school, and then by the high school, there's a big jump. And so my question is, who has that big picture? That's where I was thinking. I mean, I bet you do. You've got a very strong back. So I see the behaviorist as someone also that's working with the team chairs. But could you just say a little bit? Wrapped up in all that is the common perception now of kindergarten being the new first grade and the pressures the students are under to perform more earlier.
I think you're capturing a whole bunch of pieces that, you know, when I think of John's list of kind of our wish list of items, you're capturing a lot of that, which is the need for additional school adjustment counselors at the elementary level to help support that. We talk about, you know, our principals a lot at the elementary level, who it's just them. They don't really have assistant principals. And so one of the pieces with the team chair as an administrator was to really be a leader in their schools on special education to help support the principal as well, because the principal does everything at the building level. So really, yes, I get to be the keeper of the big picture, but I'm lucky to have a good team of team chairs and principals who work with me to keep those big picture pieces in mind, to look at their individual buildings. So there is a lot that has to be done with collaboration. And, you know, although I keep the big picture, I go down to the level of being with the principals and team chairs. We, the next few weeks, have a lot of time scheduled to do walkthroughs of our special education programs together, so that we're really looking at how things are operating on the day-to-day. Because sometimes I can get caught up mm-hmm. in the big picture, and I really want to see what is happening day-to-day. So, yes, there's a lot happening, and there are so many needs, and I think we just have to take that Walker Report and say, what are the priorities and what can we do that is reasonable, that is targeted to meet our needs right now with the budget constraints that we have. I mean, that report had many, many recommendations.
Thank you.
Okay. We'll head to the next section. Okay. Thank you.
All right, so the next section is district-wide programs. This includes health services, athletics, extracurricular activities, and networking and technology maintenance. So as with all the cost centers, we've talked a lot about the the goals, the district goals, and the five district goals. And as you can see from this chart, you can see the bolded items that support these goals from these cost centers. Really, the budget drivers in this cost center are our step increases and column changes, if applicable, COLA increases for coaches, nurses, secretaries. We did increase the offsets this year for extracurricular and the athletic revolving fund. When looking at this cost center in terms of the percentages, the largest portion of this cost center is health services at just under 40%. And we do have nurses in all of our buildings, the 1.0 equivalent in all of our buildings. At the high school, we have a nurse and the director at the high school to help service that larger population. The next largest piece of the pie, if you will, is technology at 31%, followed by athletics and extracurricular. When looking at the cost, the programs, the district-wide programs by program, athletics is the first line there, and you can see it does look like it's taking a percentage decrease, but that's a function of an increase in the offset by about $16,700 increase in the offset. Same thing is occurring in the extracurricular, and the percentage increase, because it's a smaller number, by increasing the offset by $5,000, you're making it appear that it's taking a large decrease because it is a smaller number.
Yes.
I find this part very confusing. Is there a way to bring together the change in offsets with the budgets so you can see
it's
them side
in the
by
budget
side?
Book, and it'll be the last night presentation.
It'll bring them together. So in other words, if I look at a line like extracurricular, I would see not only this 35,333, but I'd also see that there's another 5,000 coming out of offsets.
You will soon in another chart. Okay. Yeah. No, that's fair enough. Technology.
Quick question. Did you know off the top of your head the offset you used for extracurricular?
$396,666 for this year.
100?
Mm-hmm. Hang on a second. We'll get to it. It's a slide coming up.
Okay,
when you look at it by object, you know, our six object codes were the professional salaries, other salaries, clerical, they're pretty consistent. We do see an increase in other expenses that we'll see in a further slide is in network. We did put in additional funding in network and technology. We do have some equipment that is at the end of its useful life, and we want to make sure that our infrastructure and networks are supported. The staffing for these programs has remained very consistent year over year. There is one staffing change that I do want to point out. So in FY16, we budgeted to move 0.25 of a technician to the school climate transformation grant. That person took on the role of technician and data analyst. And the way the grant was structured at the time, we wrote the grant for 0.25 data analyst. A year into the grant, we've rethought that position, and Sarah Bird has written an amendment to change that to a 1.0 data analyst that's funded by the grant. So when we go through grants on Thursday night, you'll see the change there. So the operating budget is absorbing back that 0.25 technician and restoring it to a 1.0 position instead of a 0.75. So that's the only change in staffing that's in this chart. When it comes to health services, the budget drivers there really are the increases from the collective bargaining agreement. We really level funded the budget with FY16 amounts. And you can see overall it's a 0.2% increase in the budget.
Was the Narcan, that was fully funded by Rotary?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah.
For the athletics program, the budget drivers, Mr. Zaya and I thoughtfully went through the budget and looked at where we could reallocate money to kind of live within the same footprint to kind of level fund the budget again from FY16 to FY17. The increases that are reflected there are contractual increases for coaches and clerical. The contracted services that you see in the athletic budget are a function of transportation, so buses for our athletic teams for away games. The rental facilities, we do need to rent facilities to support our boys and girls swimming teams as well as our boys and girls ice hockey team. I don't believe we incur, we do have some expenses in there for you know, tennis facility rental if it's a late spring and they can't get out on the courts yet and they need some indoor, but that's all really nominal. The bulk of the facility rental is the swimming and the ice hockey.
I was wondering about gymnastics.
I want to say that we have a nominal amount in there. Right now we have the use of a gym.
Yeah, that we have for that. It's going up a little bit, but Gym Street has donated a good portion of that in the past, and there was going to be a small rental increase this year.
Oh, so they're donating it. That's why it's not a big...
Yeah, so they're letting us use it. We're lucky with a couple of our facilities, gymnastics, yeah. Golf. We don't incur a huge rental amount for that. The Gym Street is going up. We will be paying Gym Street moving forward.
Thank goodness. That they donate.
Right, yes, absolutely.
They're going up.
Yeah. No, and it's a small amount for them, so that we're appreciative of what they do for us.
I just lost my thought. It'll come back.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
Okay. When we look at participate,
I do know what it was. I'm
okay.
Sorry.
That's okay.
Dating back to when the Y was actually built instead of the outdoor swimming pool that we had, and Mr. and Mrs. Burbank were so generous with the Y. I thought I remembered some kind of arrangement that enabled the high school teams to use the swimming pool. Was that a time limited?
Yeah, we do use the pool, but
we still pay for it.
I think it's a discounted rate that we do. We're given, I think, probably good practice time. Our meet time is sort of what they give us. It's, I'm going to say, more of an off peak time for the YMCA. So our swim meets, we swim at
7 o'clock tomorrow night.
Yeah, so Saturday nights are our swimming. Home meet nights, probably not the best time, but it is a time. We do practice right after school. They give us 4 lanes to practice in.
Okay, thank you. I just remembered way back.
Wanted to touch a little bit on participation. Looking back 3 years, where the athletic user fee was consistent at $215, and so this table illustrates participation for our fall and winter sports. So I don't have spring data, so I didn't include spring in the table. You can see our football participation is at a 4-year high at 109 students. There is a slight drop off, and Tom Zaya and I talked about this a little bit today with the boys basketball and the boys ice hockey and the boys swimming. And the boys swimming seems to have peaked last year at 34, and my understanding anecdotally with Tom is that they're really the incoming freshman class has not
there's been low numbers
for swimming
last 2 years.
I think last year was one freshman or none, and mm-hmm. we've been trying to do some recruiting at the middle school level mm-hmm. to build interest.
Girls. Oh, sure. Sorry. Yeah.
So remind me of current fees. You said a few years ago.
Oh, thank you. So currently it's a user fee of $250 with an individual cap of, is it 600 or is it 500? I
think it's 600.
600 and a family cap of 900. Mm-hmm.
Do you feel that any of these lower numbers are based on those fees?
It's hard to say. I mean, I think there are some people that are feeling that. I think we're seeing a lot more people that are requesting financial relief.
Well, we do that.
We do do that, yes.
At the bottom, overall, because of football, the numbers are actually up.
Correct.
Yeah, and I think some of it varies a little bit on...
I just saw that stands out.
On the group of students that are trying out or participating as well, so...
Yes.
Isn't the number of participants partially determined by the coaches? Because those are tryout sports, right?
Yes, and that's what one of the things that we were talking about for basketball, for boys' basketball and boys' hockey, that, you know, carrying three teams, a varsity, a freshman, and a JV team with 54 kids last year was too many kids. And so I think there was a conscious effort to change the number of students that could make the team.
Yes. When our coaches do choose the teams, they'll talk with me about it on why. And I think sometimes it's because of positional players. We can't have a team with 11 goalies or something like that. So there's some good reasons that way. The hockey program last year at the JV level, we had a lot of participants, and we were getting some feedback that there were so many participants that we weren't getting enough game time. So we were trying to get as many people as we could to play, but I think in the long run it may not have been what was best with these numbers.
And was that feedback from parents and families that people weren't getting enough ice time?
And it was done with trying to get a large number of participants or maximize the participation. And I think that was sort of a trade-off.
Can I just follow up a little more?
Yes.
Do they get ice time during practice? Is it just during game time that's the complaint about?
So if we had on a hockey team 30 JV players, it's difficult to get everybody into a game. We were trying to do things where these 20 players would go to one game, and then a different 20 would go, so 10 and the other 10 would go to a different game, and it was just logistically very difficult.
Thank you.
I just was going to add, there was a bit of a capacity issue
too with the swim team, that number of, with the number of lanes that you have. It becomes hard to get that many swimmers circling and swimming hard. And so it was, you know, that may have contributed to upperclassmen not coming back, because it was the practices were a little difficult. So you reach in the capacity of the facility to handle the athletes and, you know, and then the coaches to handle good coaching for that number.
A safety issue as well.
Yeah. But I'm glad to see that those numbers, I mean, like you said, they're up. I mean, there's some puts and takes, but it doesn't look like a big impact.
So
can I just, I don't,
sure.
And I don't think you said this, I just want to make it clear, we don't ask our coaches to manage their participation based on what we need for numbers or a budget.
Correct. I will get that question from time to time. There are
that's
three extra
never.
Players on X team, and I know that's the reason is because you want the user fee money, and that's absolutely not the case. I've not been charged with that, and I would not say that.
Thank you.
The other issue, I'm whispering to Tom here, and I defer to him how much it plays into it, but we look at the trend, too. I mean, we had an enrollment dip in the high school, for instance. 2013-14 was a spike high. Next year was way 50, 60, I mean, it was significantly lower, and we're up a little bit this year. So that probably plays into it a little bit as well. In terms of percentage, might be closer than actual numbers, if that makes a difference. But
so in terms of the detail of the athletic budget, Mr. Doxer, this is where you're asking. So this is where you can see the revolving fund offset and the trend and what we've taken year over year, what's budgeted for this year and what's budgeted for next year. And you can see what Dr. Doherty and I wanted to accomplish with this year's budget was just 100% of the user fees would cover 100% of the budgeted coaching. So, and as I mentioned earlier, the other large line or the other largest expense behind coaching is our contractual services, which again is our transportation, our rental of the Burbank for our swimming program, and the ice rental.
So, excuse me, so that includes
That includes the transportation. You already said that.
Yes, it does.
Okay, athletic services is the facilities and transportation contracts.
Mm-hmm. Moving on to extracurricular, the budget drivers for this cost center or this program are our stipends due to our collective bargaining agreements. And again, we did increase our offset to the budget by $5,000 for this year. And so you can see we've increased our reliance on our offsets over the last 5 years. We're going to take $57,000 next year from the revolving fund to help support the extracurricular activities for the district.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Chairman, I'm sorry, I think I missed this, but on the previous chart, the other salaries.
Yeah, we can't do that quickly.
I'm sorry.
The other salaries is down 67%.
It's because I increased the offset by $16,700.
Oh, okay. But I thought. So, but I don't understand, why wouldn't we still show, how many did we change FTEs there? Or
no,
is that's coaches?
That's coaches. So the coaching, the stipend, there's turnover in positions when it comes to coaches, and they get placed on a schedule that has six steps. So the coaching line is going from 394 to 396, but your offset is going from 380 to 396. So your overall increase is a negative because the only expense that's being captured now is that $7,000.
I'm not understanding the $7,000 above that. Why I'm like
the $7,000, that's for event details. So for police at our football games, at our hockey games.
All right, it's me definitely. The $7,000 that's in bold is what I'm not understanding.
That's the net. That's the net for that line. So the sum of the 3696, the 7,000, and the negative is just that.
Oh, it's netting up.
Yeah.
Coming up.
That's the.
Okay, sorry.
I'm sorry for the confusion. So the bold line is the total for that object.
Right. I got it. It was just so off. It was counterintuitive that it was that those big numbers are netting up to 7,000 because of the 396 offset. I got it now.
And we're all right with. I guess Tom put you on the spot. We're all right with uniforms and stuff. I see that's going down.
10,000 is better than 7,500, but we've really been tracking our uniform and trying to get the ones that need the most attention replaced. A set of uniforms is anywhere between $3,000, so you can kind of do the math. We have 27 varsity teams. So if we stay at that level, it takes a while to get those turned over. We do have some uniforms that are aging. The turf fields have actually helped with some of our uniforms because the wear and tear is not quite as much. So that's kind of a good thing, the teams that play on turf.
But we're not going to ask parents to fund uniforms.
I have not asked for donations of.
Yeah. Oh, I know.
No.
Yeah, right, yes.
No, that's so not our intent.
That would still be my goal. But again, it may be putting some things off now a little bit longer.
But that's.
Yes.
There must be some teams that are buying their own uniforms.
Absolutely.
Like the swim team buys their own uniforms.
Absolutely.
And maybe they always have and always will, boys and girls. I was trying to remember the singlets, wrestling, maybe that the parents, didn't the parent group? The parent group bought the singlets.
There was a donation for partial singlets. Goes back probably 3 or 4 years. And I've said that, I've told Craig that when we need those, we'll purchase those. Things like the bathing suits, we can't purchase because those are personal items. Our track teams choose to buy their own because what they'll typically do is buy them as freshmen and they'll use those same uniforms.
Oh, just the shorts and the jerseys.
Correct. And some of the students want two or three track tops or two or three shorts.
Right, and their parents write the check. So I guess in those cases, similar to the athletic fee, I mean, if
the trouble is it's a little bit more difficult when it's a parent bot, because it's one thing for a parent to be able to communicate directly with you and send in the information and say, you know, I have a need, I want my student to participate, but, you know, and you get that information. I think it's a lot harder to do that when you're going through sort of the parent organizations are buying these things. So I just want to make sure that we're really, you know, looking at every sport. So, you know, maybe as we, and the budget money's not, wouldn't be there, so maybe next year, if the community steps up to the plate, there would be money. So when you look at the singlets, I'm sorry, I'm picking sports that I know, but then the parents, you know, won't be paying for those. Those are team property, and it might sound disgusting to people, but they get washed and reused. So, you know, maybe next time those can be purchased by the district instead of the parent funding. I think we just need to really keep looking at that, but it's pretty clear that this is at such a minimal level that it makes that very difficult, I think. And that's where the district refresh on the uniforms is not at a level that it should be, so quite often the parent organizations are going to, well,
And I think, too, I think that I'm trying to be mindful of the wants and the needs with some of the programs as well, so I think that what sometimes people think we need is different than what people want.
Right, like our swimmers don't have those great coats, you know, to keep all the kids warm on them.
It's so hot there. What do they want coats for?
My question was, in terms of protective gear, is that under uniforms, and do we provide that?
When you're saying protective gear,
I think an obvious example would be, I know we provide the football helmets.
Yeah.
We're keeping up with the most recent safety needs.
With the football helmets, they get sent out every season. They are actually X-rayed. They are stickered with a certification on it. If they're used that season, they're good for X amount of more time. If they're not, if they're put on the shelf because we didn't need that size, they're good for a certain amount of time. So the football helmets do get checked, they are certified. And we also try and replenish probably like 5 to 10 a season. Just so there's specific sizes and types that we have for those.
I skipped over this a little too quickly. The software licensing, that line is increasing in the budget for next year. We do have Family ID, which we use to help maintain all of our information about our student athletes. The Huddle software program is something that our coaches use. And then we have money in the budget for next year to further utilize the concussion impact testing software that we already have.
Yeah, we have that. We've been piloting it. It's a challenge to implement it with all students with the technology situations that we have. So we're trying to implement that the best way possible.
What is that? Excuse me.
The baseline concussion is students would do on a computer a baseline test. It's a memory and coordination test. What we would then do is we would save that test. If they have a suspected head injury, we would have them retake that test. When they go to get rechecked by their doctor, we would send them results with the students, and the doctor would then make a more educated decision whether the student is safe to return with a 5-step protocol coming back.
That's where you can see the increase in the software licensing from a budget to.
Oh.
So part of that is the concussion
back
test.
Up to the, just so we can clarify, the Huddle, that's HUDL, right? I don't want people to think it's just for football.
I'm sorry.
For all sports.
Yeah,
probably corrected me, but yes, you're absolutely right. Thank you for pointing that out. It's not just for football. It's for all sports Tom can speak. We have a gold package, I think. Or?
Yeah, we have. We actually have two different levels of Huddle, and it's by the users. It's a software program that takes videotaped games, practices, skill events. Coaches can videotape any of those things. They can then go back, show students either different plays, techniques that they've done right, wrong. They can email it to participants. The football team is the one that's the heavier user. They'll videotape their games. At the end of the game, they can send the results, if you will, to the players. They can break down the film the next day. What they'll also do is if for the next set of games, Coach Fiore will email the huddle video to Lexington, who Lexington can then see Reading play, how Reading did against Watertown or whatever. It's also used for students interested in college. So a student can put a highlight reel together with their plays and then send that portfolio to a college or university. It's also used by bands and color guards as well, and I've talked with Joe Mulligan about looking at implementing that as well. So the different levels that we have our football team has a ton of space that they can save it on. The rest of our teams have a sort of lesser level that is I think is more than adequate for their needs. The quality is unbelievable with a cell phone, with an iPad, or with an HD camera. It's the quality is just phenomenal.
Oh, can I just clarify? So you don't need any the camera equipment is your own personal equipment. It's really up the software, the website, and the software.
Correct. So yeah, you can use something as basic as an iPad, mm-hmm. or you can use a higher quality camera. We don't have any of that stuff. That's the teams or oh. have those.
So GoPro underwater in the pool.
Yeah, yeah.
I just have yes. one question about the concussion impact. It's not just football.
It's any sport.
What we are trying to do is implement it for everybody that is participating in a sport. We're trying to get everybody over next year tested in the building and then going with freshmen and juniors after that, so 9 and 12.
Great, okay.
The company says the results are good for 2 years. Mm-hmm. So then if somebody did have a suspected head injury, they would retake their test. And it's just been sort of a challenge. We've had it for the last year and a half. It's just a challenge the way we have our system set up to fully implement that.
How long is the testing?
It takes about 20 minutes. They say give it a half hour. It needs to be done on a computer in a quiet spot with minimal distractions, and it cannot be done on a laptop. So it's because of the mouse compared to a flat pad.
Oh, trackpad.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, thank you. So moving on to extracurricular, again, the stipends are directed by our collective bargaining agreement, and then we did increase the offset, as I mentioned earlier, by $5,000. So this budget, overall, it has a negative increase, a negative percent change, but that's really a function of the change in the revolving fund offset.
All right, I got the math going up.
Okay. Anecdotally, we have seen participation pretty consistent with our fall play. I know Ms. Killian and I spoke a little bit about overall participation between band and drama, and we don't feel that the user fee has negatively impacted participation in those programs.
Have you found, I don't know who to direct it to. Have you found that contributions outside of the user fee have been affected by the increased user fee? Like, because there's so much else the parents are pitching in for. Have the other donations gone down, or they just have?
I really haven't done an analysis on donations for the year, but I
you know, off the cuff, I
anecdotally,
say,
I don't think.
We're trying really hard to be respectful as much as possible, knowing the user fee. And you know, just being budget conscious when we spend money, like Tommy was saying. So I don't think so at this point.
I know, and again, I'll speak anecdotally. I know the band parent organization had a very thoughtful approach meeting with Joe Mulligan at the beginning of the year for what they wanted to support in terms of additional, if you can, position coaching for the band, whether it was a, you know, wind instrument support or whatnot. So I think that they had a thoughtful approach to their donations that they've made and what they're committed to supporting. So I don't think that has been impacted by the user fee. And we did not increase the user fee on the band last year. We held them harmless to try and help those numbers.
Yes.
All right. The royalties on that? Come on.
Are you asking what they are?
I'm asking, how is it zero if it's going from 2,500 to 3,500? Well, and what is the royalties? That's what we pay when we do a licensed play. We have to pay to do Mary Poppins, in other words?
Yes.
Okay.
And this is just the extracurricular revolving. So a lot of that comes from drama with some support from the extracurricular. So this doesn't reflect all the rights that we pay for.
So
it's 0% change.
I'll have to look at the formula
okay.
on that one.
Okay.
So I'm sorry, I apologize. Right. There probably are formula errors here and there, so I'll look at that one. But as Kristen was saying, we use a combination of the extracurricular budget and the drama revolving to support the drama. So there are expenditures that just get charged directly to the revolving fund.
Is that not in that 57,000 then?
That's in addition to that 57,000, yes.
So there's another, the drama revolving account?
There is a drama revolving fund, yes,
okay.
And so we take a $57,000 offset from it, but we also charge expenses directly to it. So in the past, so for example, the Mary Poppins royalties weren't charged to the operating budget, they were charged to the revolving fund. So the revolving fund supports the ongoing programmatic expenses and offsets some of the...
Oh, both, okay.
Yeah.
So we don't have that sheet yet?
No.
If I could reiterate a thought for next year's budget process to kind of reiterate what Mr. Doxer said, I think that's confusing when you know, I see revolving fund support and then find out, well, there's other revolving fund support that isn't obvious. It would be great if there was a way to make that a little bit clearer to the reader for next year.
Unless pages that we haven't.
Yeah, they're Thursday night.
Yeah. Oh, okay. So it's
even if you're going to hear about them in a few days or they're on
yeah.
a different page, if in these grids there could be an asterisk even, just something that indicated that explained it.
Well, I think the reason is sometimes people will just get, well, you know, they'll get a piece of this separately.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, without sort of that, at least something calling attention to that fact, somebody would think they have the whole picture and they don't because they need to just, you know, put it all together, so... Mm-hmm. Yes.
The last but certainly not least in the district-wide program is our network and networking and technology maintenance. And so the budget drivers here were some staff turnover. What I spoke about earlier about the restoration of that 0.25 FTE from the school climate transformation grant back onto the operating budget. It's important to note that the staff, 100% of the staff in this cost center are not on a union contract. They're employees that really only get a COLA increase. And so for this year, the budgeted COLA increase was 2.5%.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's some increases in software licensing and in network hardware. When we look at the detail by category, professional salaries, other salaries, contracted services, you can see some nominal increases. Again, the bringing back on of the 0.25, you can see that in your salaries. We budgeted for equipment to help support the network and our infrastructure, so we did put a placeholder in there for next year. We have had some significant expenses, as I mentioned earlier this week, or actually was it this week or last week, where we asked for a budget transfer for technology, where we had some interruption in manager, if you will, where we had one manager leave and we had a brief period of time where we were recruiting and hiring a new manager. Julian is here with us tonight. Thank you for being here. I'm not sure if you have specific questions about this cost center or...
I don't know.
No? I guess maybe I'm just curious on the information management networking, that's 1,200 or is that, I can't tell by the
where am I looking
coloring,
for?
Is that red or is that... Or is it just bold? Where it's under supplies and material, 0%.
Yeah, so there's two. Part of this is, I really do try to maintain this based on the DESE chart of accounts. So there's a slight differentiation between the two, whether it's information management or whether it's network and telecom. And this is really just so that they have the ability to go out and buy cables and batteries and things along that. So it's a small budget for them to purchase ancillary type of things, supplies and materials.
So that was somewhere else last year? Or because it says 0% increase there.
I'm going to have to look at, well.
But there's no number there.
I know. I'm gonna have to look at the percentage change column. I'm not sure. The only thing I can think of is if it was a negative, because it's dividing by a zero, it was giving an error message, so I just put a zero in there so that it wasn't an error message in the cell, but versus just leaving it blank.
But the $1,000 from FY16, where that's just supplies and materials, so it's not broken out into those two categories, but you're saying
it is. It's technology maintenance. It's the last one right there.
Oh, it's the last.
Yeah,
okay,
so
I see.
Yeah.
Oh, that's what I was sort of missing. I get it. Okay, so last year it was technology maintenance, and this year you sort of
I've just
in the
budgeted
other two
in those
buckets,
two, yeah.
Information management and
yeah.
Networking and telecom.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess I just have sort of a bunch of questions that I don't know where all this stuff goes. So, you know, I think we've had some issues with the phone system, which when you call in and the triage and whether or not you get connected or not, but that's not just the high school, that's like the town phone system. For the longest time, it was Rose, remember Rose Hines? Mm-hmm. It was her voice forever and ever, even after she retired. So I think of that issue, that parents interface with that. I think of the the Wi-Fi coverage within especially this building. I'm a little bit more familiar with it. I think there's some things that we would like to be doing with Edline or Retica,
mm-hmm.
you know, so that administrators and teachers can have sort of data and information at their fingertips. And then I think also of sort of building, what do we need to do in terms of, building security technology, which that may not be in this budget at all, this area at all, but building security technology and building access technology. And I don't know where any of that really sits in these, is it in this budget area or are those things that I just talked about in a different place? But
building access and security is under facilities.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
But like the...
The Wi-Fi infrastructure and the software upgrades and things like that. I can tell you the Wi-Fi infrastructure is being addressed now.
Mm-hmm.
We actually have equipment that we've already purchased and we're installing it. So that's changing dynamically as we speak. Tonight,
the phone is in the capital plan for this year, and I know I want to say in the end of December, mid-December, we did have our provider come out and work on the phone tree at the high school because it was a fairly substantial bill, and they looked at a number of things. So I do know that the capital plan for this year does have the phone system in it. I think at least for Coolidge, I know for next year we're looking at a phone system townwide because we are able to, I think we're on the same phone system with the town.
Right, Kevin and I are working to synergize between the town and the district so that we can actually leverage technology townwide and looking at replicating configurations or dial plans and technology connections between the different locations. As far as the upgrades, so there's only the one school I think that's planned for. The high school is not planned in that. There is a switch in who's responsible for maintaining the equipment as well,
mm-hmm.
which Joe and I have been talking about the possibility of my team actually taking over responsibility of maintaining the phone system so that we don't have to rely on an external vendor and the cost for that.
So, because right now, for everything that we do in the school system, for the phone system, we pay for it per change.
Right, I was shocked that we couldn't even change sort of the whole message structure themselves. I guess I had a couple too many times trying to call in and...
And you just get dropped.
Yeah, get dropped, yeah. And I'd be calling, Linda, can you just get me through? So...
Yeah, she is.
Every school phone shows up at my house as Linda. But I think, you know, again, these are important priorities, and in some cases, you know, they might not be as sort of heartstring provoking as sort of Latin or engineering or calculus or digital photography, but they support all of that. And without, you know, good tools that work when you need them, it interrupts a teacher's ability to provide the instruction or a specialist's ability to provide the service. So, you know, we chop these off because we feel like it's less painful sometimes, you know, when we have to make decisions, but it isn't. So, I mean, I'm glad to see that we're moving, you know, forward in some directions, but...
Just... forum for it, but still, I would like to mention that having been only here since October and coming from an environment that is not is a business background, working for a school system is quite different for me, but still, the the fundamentals are still the same, and that's establish a good foundation on which you can build systems off of. And quite honestly, that's where my focus is right now, is establishing the good foundation, because right now we don't have it. And that's what I'm mainly concerned about. We can start building all these great things on top of this foundation, and we're going to have problems. So that's where my focus is right now, leveraging some of the investments that we've already made in, say, Office 365, taking advantage of those things, and making things that we already have invested money into, make them work better.
So do you feel like this FY17 budget is going to provide you the ability to address the foundational issues? At least like 80% of what you would want?
So the big things that I've brought up with John, I feel like, are covered. Mm-hmm. And those are the power issues and the storage constraints that we have right now. The main data center for the district is in the high school, and we have one battery UPS that's at max, and it is also at a percentage in its life where it's diminished capacity, so it's not something we can rely on long term. But it would take a catastrophic failure for us to have an issue as a result of it. In other words, the generator would have to fail in addition to the power, in addition to the battery. So we're still good there, but it's not something you want to count on, because that's what's going to carry us over. But those things we talked about, and they are covered in this year, the battery and the storage both.
Thank you.
I had a question on the equipment line. It seems like it varies a lot year to year. $400, $1,400, $140,000, $6,800, and then up to $25,000. What's going on in that line?
Well, the $139,000, excuse me, last year was the investment that we made in the Wi-Fi at the middle schools and the high school.
Got it.
And
that wasn't capital.
Yeah.
Go
ahead. Oh, yeah, no, you're right, it wasn't. So the $25,000, why that increased this year?
For the FY17 budget,
mm-hmm.
As we mentioned, we have some concerns about the network, and I given that the budget had to be started developed the first week that Julian was here, we
gave it a
yeah. you know, and we know that that we have some issues, structural issues that we need to address. So
about software as well, is an increase there. Is that upgrades? Is it more? Is it both? And is it getting to where
that's focus? The license for the arrays is the increase for that.
Is there a,
yes.
Like, is there a
That's just supporting the hardware.
Yeah.
The management system for the wireless arrays.
That's the increase to the 31,000. That's the line item you're looking at, Mark?
Mm-hmm.
20.
So you mentioned Office 365. Are there upgrades going on in software in general?
So the investment into Office 365 is, I don't know where it's getting paid from, but it's already
there. It's in
there.
The regular day budget.
Okay, yeah. So it's not something new. It's been paid for.
And funded.
Yeah, for a while now.
So this really is very specific to the network?
Correct. This is the last of tonight's presentation. On Thursday night, we'll have the school town facilities. Joe Huggins will be here with us. We'll review grants and the revolving funds in more detail on Thursday night. We'll also have the public hearing and address any questions that we have from the committee and other members from the public.
Questions on the 21st.
Any questions that we receive from the committee between now and the 21st that we're able to answer, we certainly will do our best.
In advance of the meeting, like we usually do.
Exactly, yeah.
Okay. And the 19th is another selectmen's meeting, right?
Yes. Next Tuesday.
It's the 19th. And then the... what's not up there is, the FinCom is up there. I'm sorry. Thank you. The Wednesday, the 20th, is the financial forum, which will be at the Senior Center. And that's Wednesday night at 7:30. And then our meeting is Thursday.
And we still have the 28th held open if we need it. So.
Correct.
Is that Ricasa, but it's earlier, right?
It's at 5:30.
Okay, yeah.
The Thursday, the 28th, is at 5:30?
No. Our CASA is on Thursdays. It's the 28th, but it's 5:30 to 6:30, and we're 7.
We're at 7, correct.
So, like, three or more of us are on RACASA, right?
Yes, Dr. Doherty is on it as well.
Thank you.
Oh, we have to adjourn? No.
Sorry. Unless there's other questions. Thank you for participating tonight.
Thanks, everybody, for hanging in to the chair. Move to adjourn.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor, 5-0.
I have a question.